So let's go ahead and move forward with Gian Dionigi. He is a professor of surgery and chief of the endocrine surgical unit in Messina University in Sicily, and he will be speaking on the application of nerve monitoring to our new approaches in transoral, being an expert both in neural monitoring and in transoral surgery.
Thank you. So thank you for this invitation. I'd like to thank Greg, Medtronic, for this opportunity. So aim of this presentation will be neural monitoring in transoral endoscopic thyroidectomy. So these are the contents of my speech. And the first one is that with this new approach, the endoscopic transoral approach, the management of the recurring GNEV is completely different than in open procedure and also in other endoscopic procedure. First of all, because the view is now from caudal, from cranial to caudal, and also the angle is from up to below. So this, for example, is a view, so the nerve is usually identified, this is the left side, at the larynx entry point and between 9 to 10 according to this scheme. This is the point I think is extremely important for those surgeons approaching the transoral approach, that in comparison with open procedure and in comparison with other endoscopic procedure, the landmarks that the surgeon has during the procedure to identify the recurrent nerve are less. So in comparison with open procedure offers more landmarks for recurrent GNEV identification than the transoral approach. And this is a scheme that I would like to offer, but it's not only for landmarks. The approach, the dissecting, the exposure of the nerve, usually in open surgery, we always do an hybrid approach, dissecting the nerve caudal to cranial or cranial to caudal, while in the endoscopic transoral approach can be only cranial to caudal. So for these issues, there is a limitation of surgical approach and identification of the recurrent nerve. So for those surgeons not using monitoring, we will see now, I think is important to use it, because the landmarks and the way of dissection of the nerve in the transoral approach are fewer than in open procedure. And this is what I was stating. So in TOETVA, open surgery offers more modes for recurrent nerve dissection. TOETVA induces technical changes in the surgical practice and offers less mode for recurrent nerve identification and dissection. This is an important issue. Monitoring was first time described in transoral endoscopic thyroidectomy by a group from Germany, from Witzel. And this was a case that they used a percutaneous stimulating probe. And also another paper described the use of monitoring in transoral endoscopic thyroidectomy. This is a video presentation by the group from Mon Sanai. I think it's extremely important when you're using monitoring to adapt the guidelines that were published for the open procedure to the endoscopic one, but I will try to show you that there are some limitation about it. So these are the guidelines that we wrote for the open procedure. Can these guidelines be proposed also for the transoral approach? Definitely, when you are doing the endoscopic procedure in general, not only for the transoral, the stimulating probes can be different. Each of these devices have some pros and cons. For example, for the percutaneous one, of course, is flexibility. You can do continuous monitoring by using this probe and just ask your assistant to keep it close to the vagal nerve. The long probe is useful because for its versatility, you can use it in different trackers. As for the recording electrodes, this is obvious. We need an endotracheal tube-based electrode because all the other issues for recording SAR are not available, cannot be used during the endoscopic procedure. A question that is often asked, is it better nasotracheal intubation or oral tracheal intubation for the EMG tube? And this is another slide I try to summarize the pros and cons of nasotracheal or oral tracheal. Usually is the anesthesiologist's preference, but please keep in mind that when you're using the oral tracheal tube, the diameter of the tube is perfect, just in contact with the vocal cords, while when you're using the nasotracheal tube, you need a smaller tube, so the amplitude usually is smaller. So this is an important issue. Monitoring, usually the monitor is fixed close to the IHD video, so stands at the foot of the patient. And this way, and as well for the procedure, again, I think is important to use all the standardized procedure commonly used in open procedure and also in the transoral approach, so the V1, R1, R2, and V2. And usually the approach to the vagal nerve is medial to the strap muscle and not intermediate or lateral. And this is the same slide of before. This is the long probe. As you can see, this is at the end of the surgical procedure. It's a left side. This is the recurringer nerve. We are bringing inside the long probe. Long probe should be at least 30 centimeters long. We are testing R2, and then we will test. You will see it in a few seconds, also the vagal nerve stimulation V2 signal. This is the percutaneous way of stimulation. You have to do as little mark on the skin, insert the percutaneous one, the percutaneous probe, and then you go inside and you insert the probe into the surgical field. Actually, this is probably the most common way now to monitor because these probes are commonly in your operating room, so you don't need to any administration to ask for a long one. This is a weak point of transoral endoscopic thyroidectomy and monitoring association. Why? Definitely we can use all the guidelines for the correct EMG endotracheal tube position verification test. That is to say, we can verify the impedance, we can verify intra and post-op, intra and preoperatively the position of the tube, the tap test, the respiratory variation, and the V1 higher than 500. But as you know, when we have a problem during monitoring and we have to test and we have to use some algorithms like correct tube position, stimulation of the recurringer nerve at entry point or ipsilateral vagal nerve stimulation or the Lindor twitch or stimulation of the contralateral vagal nerve stimulation. These issues, these surgical maneuvers or anesthesiological maneuver can be a little bit problematic during the endoscopic procedure. For example, if you have a nasotracheal intubation and all the field is closed, you have to ask your anesthesiologist to reposition the tube. And if you have to stimulate the contralateral vagal nerve, is another way of dissection. It takes you maybe 20 or 30 minutes to dissect the contralateral vagal nerve. And lastly, Laryngeal twitch evaluation is possible, is very difficult. You can see something with the endoscope, but is extremely difficult with your cranial to caudal view. So probably the algorithms that we are using in open surgery for monitoring solving problems cannot be used completely in the endoscopic procedure. So this is a video for the continuous monitoring in transoral endoscopic procedure. I showed it yesterday. So it took us 45 minutes to put this probe on the vagal nerve of a pig, and it took too much time. And definitely, we need something more simpler to be used in endoscopic procedure. And this is just a short video. Just shortly, it is also possible to monitor the superior laryngeal nerve. Marcin will give us an update on it. This is a list of the strategies for safe after thyroid pole management, both for the vessels and for the superior laryngeal nerve. And you can read the list. And this is a short video that show you how to the identification of the branch of the superior laryngeal nerve. And as you can appreciate here by the video, to have a safety view of this vessel and of the external branch, you have to engrave a little the sternothyroid muscle. And if we analyze the standardized steps for superior laryngeal nerve monitoring, it is very difficult to achieve the S2 stimulation, that is to say the stimulation of the superior laryngeal nerve more proximally, because it means that you have to dissect more upwards, and for the cranial to caudal view, this is quite difficult to achieve. So, in conclusion, I think this is important to know from for all of you. I started my surgical procedure that all my chief told me that you must look for the nerve at entry point, or you must dissect only the nerve from cranial to caudal. But this is extremely difficult in transoral procedure. Because some of the landmarks and some of the dissections mode cannot be applied during the transoral endoscopic procedure. So I really think that in the navigation of recurrent nerve management during transoral thyroidectomy, narrow monitoring is important, as well as for the companies, transoral endoscopic procedure is a very good opportunity to improve technology and device for this technology. So thank you very much, Greg.
So do we have any questions for Gian about the application of monitoring through transoral and endoscopic procedures? Gian, what your most commonly used procedure then is the transcutaneous?
So currently is the percutaneous one, or the long one when the long one is available.
These are very important issues. You know, the geometry of the tip of the stimulator has to do with the sensitivity and specificity of the stimulation at different levels. So, and then, you know, there's bipolar stimulators, and so each stimulator has a different kind of profile. There are some stimulators that are better for initial mapping of the nerve, where you get a bigger false positive circle. There are some stimulators, like bipolar stimulators, that are a little bit better at sensitivity and specificity for final prognostic stimulation. So, you know, connecting up to the Maryland dissector. So let me ask you also that, I mean, I saw a little pulsatile whitish strip of the carotid artery that you were stimulating lateral to. Would you just describe a little bit about vagal stimulation? And Gian has done some very nice work on vagal anatomy within the carotid sheath, that you don't necessarily need to visualize the vagus nerve as such in order to stimulate it. There are circumstances where that is required, but could you just describe a little bit about where the vagus is and how you typically just kind of place the stimulator? Where do you do that? How do you do that?
Actually, in the endoscopy procedure, we don't go and look for the vagal nerve, but we just stimulate, putting the probe on the carotid artery or on the jugular vein and press gently down with a stimulation between 2 and 3. So actually we don't know where is the vagal nerve, but we only stimulate the on the carotid sheath.
So without
dissecting the carotid sheath.
We should just cover that issue of level of stimulation. So if you have a nerve that's dissected out completely with no fascia at all on it in a totally dry field, and put a stimulator on it, stimulator down on 0, and start to tick it up by 0.1 milliamp increments. When does the nerve first fire? It's about 0.3 milliamps. That's in a dry field with no fascia. And then when does it max out? At about 0.8 milliamps. Is it safe to stimulate repetitively all the way up to 2? It is. So basically when we have the nerve in our field, we typically stimulate, and any panelists that disagree with this, raise your hand and comment, but typically at 1 milliamp, which is a nice supra threshold. I'm gonna for sure depolarize the nerve if I'm touching it level. There would be no harm to going to 2, but there's no real point in doing it. 1 would be sufficient to fully depolarize the nerve. But you see, when he was looking for it, he wants a bigger false positive circle around that stimulator. He wants to entrain more tissue in order to map out the nerve. That's true of vagal stimulation. It's true of, Quan mentioned this issue of neural mapping. That is, before you really visualize the nerve and you know its potential trajectory, you can stimulate the nerve and identify it in a linear positive path of stimulation. East and west of that stimulation in the paratracheal region is negative, and you would want to usually map at a level of about 2 milliamps, or as Gian was saying, searching for the vagus, maybe at 3 milliamps. Any other questions? Any other, we want to make sure that especially problems, yes, please.
Thank you. In some videos, you can see that the nerve is being touched for 5, 6, 7 seconds. Sometimes I like to just touch it and stimulate it for maybe a second or two. Mm-hmm. Does it make any difference? Can you harm the nerve?
Okay. So I'll ask the panelists' judgment. There are studies that have been published, especially with continuous monitoring, where the vagus nerve is repetitively stimulated every 6 seconds for whatever the duration of the procedure is, where 1 or 2 milliamps have been delivered to the nerve 2,500 times during a procedure that lasts several hours, without any neuropraxia. So this pulsatile, when you stimulate the nerve, it's a 100 millisecond pulsatile stimulation. It's a very short duration, and it has been proven over and over again to be absolutely safe to the nerve. That is not necessary, and also there's an issue not only of could you be injuring the nerve, but also recurrent nerve by stimulation in a prolonged way. The answer is really no, as long as you're going between 1 and 2 milliamps. There's a second issue of if you stimulate the vagus, could there be bradycardia or some bronchospastic changes? So Gian, okay, could you comment on the safety of vagal stimulation?
This is an important question because, for example, in endoscopic or more commonly in robotic thyroidectomy, they put the APS on the vagal nerve and maybe the procedure takes 2 or 3 hours, okay, for just a lobectomy. So you put the APS for 2 or 3 hours on the vagal nerve. So together with some Koreans at the Yonsei, we did a study, we put the APS for 7, 8 hours, stimulating 3, 4 till 10, okay, and with different groups of pigs, okay, and the nerve was injured only from 10 above. But 10, we will never achieve a 10 milliampere of stimulation, okay, while in all the other groups, till 10, stimulating for 7 hours, the vagal nerve, okay, nothing happened to the pig. Okay.
Quan?
I just want to ask a question. You know, one of the main argument for doing continuous nerve monitoring is it picks up the traction injury of the nerve. One of the advantages of endoscopic operation is you actually have less traction of the nerve because of the way you dissect. So in some way, continuous nerve monitoring may actually be less useful for your endoscopic operations than for your regular operations. And as you know, in the United States, it's not a common thing to do continuous nerve monitoring.
So, Gian, is this true, that an endoscopic procedure does not result in traction as much as an open procedure? I'd find that a little bit not so intuitive.
I have two observations. The feedback of traction is not good during surgery. So the feedback we have in open procedure of our traction, we know. Okay, we have a good feedback. We are doing what our system is doing. While in endoscopic and in robotic, we don't have a complete feedback.
It isn't your hands, it's the instruments.
And for the areola approach, for example, that we are going from caudal to cranial, there is a lot of traction of the lobe because the view is below. So we have the only way to see the nerve is tractioning the thyroid lobe. Yeah. So definitely I think FPS is...
But from the transoral though, you can't dissect out the proximal part of the nerve. You have to go for where it enters. So do you have any data on whether or not the traction is
I think this is not a good study about the mechanism of injury during the transoral or the other endoscopic procedure. This is extremely important.
So I want to just mention one point that relates to that, because that's really inherent in all of this is, you know, we're having an injury to the nerve, and then we're watching what happens to the EMG. So we have to be fair to this model of a lens looking at nerve injury, that it depends on whether you're hit by a bicycle, hit by a bus, or dragged by a Mack truck, right? It depends on the injury as to what happens. So if you cut the nerve, monitoring is not going to be helpful at all, even continuous monitoring. It'll be good, and then precipitously it'll be bad. The more the injury, which is sometimes not always known, you hear Quan and Gian talking about, we don't even maybe know the degree of mechanisms of injury. Do you always know what hurts the nerve? Do you always know how much that injury was delivered, over what time frame that injury was delivered? So trauma is variable. It is really just the slowly delivered injury, which is most typically traction injury, which is delivered over some period of time. Fortunately, that's the most common injury, and so there is time enough for EMG to slowly evolve as that injury is slowly being delivered to the nerve. More precipitous and complete injury, like say complete cautery or clamping of the nerve, is much less of a model where monitoring would be useful.